Thank you very much. Image-guided tumor treatments. So most of what I do is through a very tiny incision. It's minimally invasive and the recovery tends to be fairly quick. When we look at liver tumors, these are 2004 numbers and they're actually on the rise. But liver tumors, it's much more common to have a metastatic tumor, something that started somewhere else in the body and made it to the liver, than it is to have a primary liver tumor. We are seeing an increase in tumors from different tumor types that go to the liver, whether that's neuroendocrine, ocular melanoma, or colorectal cancer. I think this is the cornerstone of cancer treatment today. And the patients are best served by having a multidisciplinary approach with differing physicians all weighing in on what's the best thing to do at that time. And I like the way that Dr. Quartz puts it. When I see a patient that's seen him, the patients all say, well, Dr. Quartz said we should play the cards in this order. And it's important because there are lots of different things that we could do to that tumor, but it's important to treat them in the appropriate order so that you don't limit any options in the future. So these are the people that I work closely with, both radiation medical and surgical oncology, and then some of the work that we do with radioembolization involves physicists and nuclear medicine as well. Similar to Dr. Quartz, when I see a patient in clinic, I need to determine whether that patient really needs a local ablative technique, so either burning or freezing a couple of small tumors. And if you look at this picture on the left, there's one tumor on the back side of the liver, whereas this patient has multiple tumors spread throughout the liver. One tumor, it's easy to do an ablation. Multiple tumors, that's when we look at more of a regional liver therapy. This is, in my mind, when we look at things, how do these patients break down? How do we treat them? If there are three tumors less than 3 centimeters in size, those tend to be ablatable using the techniques that Dr. Court spoke about. Regional treatments are if the tumors are more diffuse or spread out, and also if they're difficult in difficult locations to treat with some of these needle-based therapies. Cytoreduction. One of the theories out there is to decrease the amount of tumor burden that the patient has so that the therapy that we use works better. And cytoreduction is something that we subscribe to. Local ablative techniques, we can do these percutaneously in certain circumstances. And if I see a patient who clearly needs a surgical operation to do an ablation, then I'll send him to Dr. Quartz. If it's something I can do percutaneously, then I'll take that on myself. We'll also talk a little bit about external beam radiation therapy. There's only about 10 to 20% of patients that can actually have a surgery. Most of these patients with liver tumors have them in locations or numbers that are not amenable to surgery. This is a patient with a hepatocellular carcinoma within the backside of the right lobe of the liver. We put the probe in under ultrasound or CT guidance. We then put energy into that probe and burn up the tissue at the tip of the needle. And if you have a 3 centimeter tumor, you want to use a 4 centimeter probe because you don't want to just burn the tumor. You want to create a nice surgical margin that eradicates the tumor tissue as well as burn into normal liver tissue to decrease the recurrence. This is what it looks like as you start to burn. We create little microbubbles that we can see with ultrasound. And this is what, the imaging isn't great, but this is what it looks like on a CT scan. Here's the baseline prior to treatment, 6 months after ablation, and then 1 year after ablation. You should know that this liver will never look normal. As you burn these tumors, you eradicate the tumor, but it looks a little bit like Swiss cheese. Wherever you've had an ablation, you're going to see a dark spot, which is usually dead tissue, but it doesn't repopulate with normal tissue in that area. Radiofrequency ablation is something that's been used for a long time in colorectal cancer and has been proven effective. We also use microwave ablation, which is just a needle or a sharp antenna that we put in. The ablation zones are a little bit larger with this device than radiofrequency ablation. Cryoablation, we do freeze things down to minus 40 degrees centigrade. That is lethal and kills the tissue. We use this technology in kidneys, we use it in lungs, and we use it in livers. This is a tumor on the backside of the left lobe of the liver. You can see that with the arrow. It's very close to the pancreas and stomach. You couldn't just put a radiofrequency ablation probe in here and burn this because you'd also injure the other adjacent organs, like the pancreas. So this is an instance where we actually put in a cryoablation probe, and then froze it. And you can see this ball of ice, which is right here surrounding the probe, not damaging any of the adjacent tissue. PET imaging is the injection of radioactive sugar. It goes to areas of very high metabolic uptake. This is a case from a doctor in Miami, Dr. Raj, and this is pre-ablation. There's a tumor with increased metabolic activity within the right lobe of the liver, and this is 6 weeks after NanoKnife, showing that that tumor is dead or does not take up any sugar. Treatment follow-up, most patients are getting scanned about every 3 months. Contrast-enhanced CAT scan or PET scan, depending on insurance. Tumor markers are very important to follow, and I will tend to trust the tumor markers more so than the imaging studies. You can't look at any of these in a vacuum. You need to look at it all together, but it's important to look at tumor markers as well as imaging studies. We do have a device over at Sky Ridge Medical Center that allows us to triangulate in and treat tumors. It's electromagnetic guidance, and it allows me to virtually place needles without ever piercing the skin, create the exact trajectory that I need, and it makes the procedure much, much quicker and safer for the patient. Stereotactic radiosurgery, also known as CyberKnife or Novalis, that's something that's playing in this field. That device is very good at local control. It's non-invasive, and there are still some work to be done in that area. Regional cancer therapy, there's transarterial chemoembolization, drug-eluting beads, and radioembolization, and we'll go through those quickly. The way that these therapies work inside of the liver is that tumors have a much larger blood supply than the normal liver tissue that they reside within. And that can be anywhere from 3 times greater blood supply up to 20 times, depending on the tumor type. So when we infuse particles into the hepatic artery, they're going to get sumped into these tumors where they get lodged and they exert their local effect, whether that's radiation or chemotherapy. Who is best for liver-directed treatments? The mainstay of metastatic disease is chemotherapy. But there are patients with liver-dominant disease who could benefit from these types of therapies. The most important predictor that somebody's going to be able to tolerate this would be a bilirubin less than 2. That's a measure of how much hepatic reserve the patient has. Chemoembolization, the thought 30 years ago was, how could we get a chemotherapeutic agent into the area of the tumor, work locally with decreased toxicity to the rest of the body? Initially, they would mix up the chemotherapy along with some gel foam or other things that would slow down the blood supply into the liver. They'd inject the chemotherapy, this mixture together. It would stop the blood supply, and the chemotherapy would sit there for a little bit longer than if you just injected it and it washed right through the liver. This is a tumor within the backside of the right lobe of the liver. This is an angiogram just showing the increased blood supply to that same area. And this is after we treated it with chemoembolization, and that shows the chemotherapeutic agent is really locked inside of the tumor. There really hasn't been much advance in the treatment of hepatocellular carcinoma up until recently with the advent of sorafenib. So most of these patients would get treated with kind of this slurry chemoembolization, and they'd get it every 3 to 6 months. Drug-eluting beads, these have come on the market probably in the last 7 years. This is a bead that actually soaks in chemotherapy. It sucks up the chemotherapy over about 3 hours. We then infuse it into the patient, into the tumors, and like a sponge, it slowly lets go of the chemotherapy over about 2 weeks. This is a patient with colon cancer. You can use different types of chemotherapy. Irinotecan is known to be active against colon cancer, so we try and target the chemotherapy specifically for that tumor type, although it's not quite that precise. Patients who are treated with drug-eluting beads or chemoembolization, they tend to have a post-embolization syndrome where they get a little bit sick. They can have nausea, pain, low-grade fevers within that first day or two, and then they recover, which is opposite of radioembolization. These are just 2 trials. One was looking at hepatocellular carcinoma. The other was looking at colon cancer. And it doesn't show that people lived longer if you use drug-eluting beads versus chemoembolization, but it did show that they tolerated it better. This is radioembolization. So again, the whole idea is to concentrate whatever therapy it is in the tumors. When we look at this graph, it says that this is looking at doses of radiation to the liver and the tumors. we know that the liver can only get 30 gray, which is a measure of radiation, and then it starts to die because of the radiation to the liver. The tumors need about 70 to 90 gray to get killed. So the question is, how do you preferentially get this high dose radiation into the tumors and spare the liver? So by using this increased blood supply or sumping effect from the tumors, they actually pull these beads, the radioactivity, into the tumors and spare the rest of the normal liver tissue. And that's how we can get away with giving very high doses of radiation to the tumor with relatively low doses to the rest of the liver. This electron micrograph of the beads are about 30 microns in size and contain yttrium-90. You should know that when anybody gets treated with these beads, the tumor markers will go up after the treatment. So usually tumor markers are starting high to begin with. After we treat, they're going to peak at about 2 weeks, and then they'll start to drop off at about 6 to 8 weeks. So if somebody were treated with radioembolization and got their labs drawn right afterwards, the tumor markers would be higher than where we started. This is a study looking at FOLFOX, which is state-of-the-art chemotherapy, with or without the radioactive beads. Patients show that they responded to the, this is pre, and these are tumors in the right side of the liver. This is afterwards, so the tumor shrunk down. The center is very dark, necrotic, meaning that the center is dead. And this patient underwent a resection and had that right lobe of the liver removed, along with all of his disease. When we look at the chemotherapy and the use of radioactive microspheres, there's a big study going on right now, which is a worldwide study. It looks like from the early data that the earlier you use the radioactive microspheres, the better improvement in survival. So if you're using it along with first-line therapy, those patients tend to do better than if you use it as a salvage therapy. Although we've seen patients in each of those subgroups, first-line, second-line salvage therapy, show an improvement in survival over chemotherapy alone. So it's going to be very interesting to see what this study shows. The study is closed. It's about 500 patients throughout the world. They were looking at patients who received standard of care therapy, which is FOLFOX and Avastin, versus patients who got FOLFOX and Avastin and the radioactive microspheres. And they're going to track the patients and see how the tumors respond, as well as how the survival is. So it looks like the results are promising, but it won't be out until probably early next year. Also, there's this therapy, the radioactive microspheres, work in other disease processes. This is something that we did about 10 years ago, looking at patients with neuroendocrine tumors, 148 patients, and the median survival in the patients that we treated was about 70 months, which is pretty good considering the standard chemotherapy, or I should say chemoembolization therapy, the survival was about 36 months. And tumor markers are very reflective of the response to the disease. This is a chromogranin, which is another tumor marker, just showing that it goes up after treatment and comes back down to baseline. This is before and after treatment with the radioactive microspheres. This is a PET scan with the radioactive sugar showing the increased uptake within the liver. This was after one treatment and two treatment, and now the liver is fairly sterilized from this process. We're not fooling ourselves. This is a metastatic process that circulates throughout the body, but we're pretty good at treating tumors within the liver. They can recur, but we can go back in and retreat them. We have treated patients with breast metastases. There are a couple of papers out there. We've treated patients with ocular melanoma and liver metastases. So this is a therapy that crosses many disease states. So in summary, if you have a tiny tumor, it's better served with a local ablative technique. If you have many tumors spread throughout the liver, that's probably better with a regional therapy. And I think for the patients to get the best care, they should be involved in this multidisciplinary discussion of how to best treat the tumors. Thank you.